In the last video, we hopefully got the intuition between how real interest rates might impact planned investment. We saw that if real interest rates went up, then planned investment went down. If real interest rates went down, then planned investment went up. What we want to do in this video is take this conclusion right over here, this hopefully fairly intuitive conclusion right over here, and apply it to our Keynesian cross and think about how real interest rates would affect overall planned expenditure and then what that would do in a model like the Keynesian cross, what that would do to our equilibrium real GDP. So just as a reminder, so let's just draw our Keynesian cross first, or parts of it. So on this axis right over here, we have expenditures. This axis right over here, we have income. And we know from many videos now that an economy is in equilibrium when income is equal, when aggregate real income is equal to aggregate real expenditures, circular flow of GDP. So let me make a line that's all the points where y is equal to expenditures. So along this 45-degree line right over here, so this is our expenditures. At this point right over here, that should be the same value as what our aggregate income is. Now that's part of the Keynesian cross. The other part is to actually plot planned expenditures relative to this and then see where they intersect. What is the equilibrium point on that planned expenditure line? And I'll write it here as, I've written it in the past as planned, I just wrote out the word, planned expenditures. We could write it even as, we could write it as expenditures planned, like that. And it's equal to our aggregate consumption. And our aggregate consumption, we can write it as a function of disposable income. Y minus T is disposable income. Aggregate income minus aggregate taxes. And I want to be very clear here. This is not saying C times Y minus T. This is saying C is a function of Y minus T. Give me a Y minus T, and I will give you a C. And for the sake of our Keynesian cross analysis, and this is kind of what you would see in a traditional intro class, we assume that we have a linear consumption function. So we assume that our consumption function, so C as a function of disposable income, it might be something like our autonomous consumption plus our marginal propensity to consume times our aggregate income minus taxes. So this right over here really is multiplication. We could really distribute this C1. This is just saying C as a function of Y minus T. So that's only one part of planned expenditures. Above and beyond that, we have investment, planned investment. We're talking about the planned side of things. And now we know that planned investment, in the past we viewed it as a constant, but now we know it can actually be a function of real interest rates. And then above and beyond that, we have government expenditures and then net exports. So for some given real interest rate, we can plot this line. The consumption function right over here is just a line with a positive slope that intersects the vertical axis at some place up here. It has a positive intercept. And so all of these, for a given interest rate, these are all going to be constant. And so our planned expenditures would look something like this. So it might look something like that. So this is YP, let's call this YP underscore 1. And this is the YP we get when we pick, and I'll just rewrite the whole thing over again. So we have our consumption, which is a function of Y minus T, plus the level of planned investment at, let's say, interest rate R1, so at some given interest rate, plus government spending, plus net exports. And we see, we've done this Keynesian cross analysis several times now already. This is our equilibrium level of GDP. This is where, along our planned expenditure line, where income is equal to expenditures, or where output is equal to expenditures. We have a balanced, we are at equilibrium right over here. We aren't having unplanned, we're not eating into inventories in an unplanned way, and we're not building excessive inventories above and beyond what we had planned. Now what I want to think about, what happens if interest rates go from R1 to R2? So what happens if interest rates go from R1 to R2? And in particular, let's assume that R2, so now we're going to have planned investment at R2, and we're going to assume that R2 is less than R1. So we're essentially saying, what happens when interest rates go down? Well, we already know, when interest rates go down, planned investment goes up. So everything else equal, if this thing shifts up, if this term right over here goes from R, if the input into it, if the real interest rates goes down, then this whole expression is going to go up. And so you're going to have an increase. You're going to have a shifting up of your planned expenditures for any level of income. And so it might look something like this. It would look something like this. So this delta right over here, So this distance right over here is going to be your change in planned investment. And it went up because interest rates went down. We saw that in the last video. And we saw that we got to a new level, or we see now that when you shift that up, that investment goes up because real interest rate went down, you get to a new equilibrium point. And that equilibrium point is a higher level. It's a higher level of GDP or income. And we know from previous videos as well that this distance right over here is the same as our multiplier times the amount that things got bumped up. So the amount that things got bumped up was the change in planned investment, and then we'd multiply that times our multiplier, and our multiplier is 1 over the marginal propensity to save, or 1 over 1 minus the marginal propensity to consume. And the marginal propensity to consume, if we assume, and we assume it's going to be constant in order to even be able to do this math, that's this piece right over there. So that is equal to our C1. But the main theme here, the real big picture here, as we go on our way to constructing our ISLM model, is really that all we're seeing, look, interest rates, when real interest rates go up, planned investment goes down. When interest rates go down, which is what we saw in this example right over here, so actually let me write this down. So planned expenditures 2, it's C as a function of y minus t plus our new planned investment at this lower interest rate plus g plus net exports. This is our y2 right over here, our planned expenditures. So we saw in this example, when real interest rates went down, planned investment went up, and that made total planned expenditures go up, and that made total GDP go up. So now we can have another relationship, which is really very analogous to this, because really, by changing this, we're just shifting this curve, and then you have the multiplier effect on our equilibrium output. So the big takeaway from here is, if real interest rates go up, not only does planned investment go down, that would shift this entire curve down, and then that would also cause our equilibrium real GDP to go down. And it would go down by some multiplier, by the multiplier of how much this goes down. If real interest rates go down, then planned investment, because of what we saw in the last video, goes up. And then that would cause this whole, that's what we did in this video, this curve would shift up. And if this curve shifts up, our equilibrium GDP is going to be however much this shifted times the multiplier. And so your equilibrium GDP is going to go up. So you really have a very similar relationship in terms of just how things move. And we can plot this, and economists are famous for not always plotting the independent variable the way you would want to. So as we construct our, what we're going to see is our IS curve, and it stands for investment savings. What we're going to do, and we'll talk more about that in the future, we plot, the convention is to put real interest rates on the vertical axis, and to put real GDP right over here. And so if you want to look at this relationship, when we have a high real interest rate, we're going to have a low real GDP. And when we have a low real interest rate, we're going to have a high GDP, because it helps, it's going to make spending go up. Spending goes up, you have a multiplier effect, makes our equilibrium output go up. So low interest rate, high real GDP, and so you have a curve that relates, if you want to relate real GDP to real interest rates, you get a curve like this, and it's called the IS curve. And IS comes for investment savings. But we're really more focused on the I part of it, the way we analyzed here. Because the whole reason, based on the logic in this video, and the last one as well, the whole reason why we have this relationship is due to real interest rates' impact on investment. When you have high real interest rates, you don't have much investment, and that also, you'll be sapping out of GDP. If you lower interest rates, then that makes you end up having a lot more investment, like we saw in the last video, and that will expand GDP by the multiplier that we see right over there.